Support for Steppin' Out is made possible by Yes Portrait. New Orleans portrait artist Pragati Dar specializes in personal portraits in oil or pencil. She uses her many years of experience to bring her portraits to life. More information is available at yesportrait.com.
Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin' Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, John Kemp, art columnist for Louisiana Life magazine. Hello, John.
Hey, Peg.
Hey there.
Mm-hmm. Hello.
Poppy Tucker, host of the weekly program Louisiana Eats on WWNO Radio. Hi, Poppy.
Hey, Peg.
Hello, dear. Making his Steppin' Out debut, photographer Richard Sexton, here to discuss his brand new book, Creole World, Photographs of New Orleans and the Latin American Sphere. Hey, Richard. Thanks
Hi,
for being with us.
Hello. Yes, thanks for having me.
And Alan Smason, editor of the online Crescent City Jewish News, who of course covers the local theater scene for us. Hello, sir.
Great to be back.
But we are delighted to be talking about yet even more brand new Vietnamese restaurants.
Asian restaurants abounding. That's the topic this week. The first place I want to point out is I got whiplash, a place called Asuka. I'm driving down Earhart Boulevard, and there's this little tiny place that says sushi and hibachi. Wow, gotta stop there. I'm so glad I did. The food's fabulous. It's incredibly reasonable. An order with two pieces of sushi or a traditional roll is $4.95. They have specialty dishes like the golden salmon, which is a lightly seared fresh Scottish salmon that's sprinkled with Hawaiian volcano salt, organic peppercorn, and yuzu. Something I had there that was so good. It's not on the menu yet. Cubes of escalar in a halved avocado with a ginger ponzu sauce on top. Delish. But let's move on to Vietnamese.
And this is right off Carrollton.
It is right off of Carrollton, okay. Right on Earhart. If you blink,
towards
you,
town.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you blink, you might miss it.
Okay.
So catch it. It's
right.
It's worth every penny. Delicious food. Louis Lou. Okay, now. How many Vietnamese restaurants can we possibly have in this town? This one just popped up on Magazine Street. It's Pho Cam Ly. They're open 7 days a week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. It's very traditional Vietnamese, your typical banh mi, etc. But pho, okay? Here at this place, here's the big deal. The pho challenge. For $30, you can try your hand or your stomach at an enormous bowl of pho that includes 2 pounds of noodles, 2 pounds of meat, and if you can eat the whole thing in a prescribed length of time, they're going to take your picture, give you a t-shirt, and comp your big 4 pound bowl of pho. So, okay. So now, about something completely different. Not traditional Vietnamese. With roots in traditional Vietnamese, a place called Nami's Vietnamese Cafe. This place has the most incredible food. The Doan family operated a typical sort of boiled seafood convenience store takeout business. Look at the outdoor dining under the spreading oak trees on North Carrollton. Too bad it was raining that day, but I'm going back as soon as it's sunny again. And they had this business for 26 years. Their son, Hugh, the second generation, has transformed that humble seafood store into one of the most fascinating new takes on Vietnamese food that honestly I've seen for a while. Everything is house-made there. They cure and smoke their own bacon. They make incredible ice cream from scratch. They even make their own butter there. Mm-hmm. And on the menu, what's really interesting is you see words that you don't normally see, like chimichurri, aioli, and bruschetta. You don't see that on Vietnamese menus much. And they also have a very adventurous craft cocktail list that includes lemongrass or lychee martinis, and they have fine wines by the bottle or the glass.
Just to give a context, that is on the corner of Carrollton and
Tulane,
across from where the old location of Rock and Roll was.
Exactly. Yeah. The most shocking thing.
Location.
Unlikely and a complete transformation. You would never think it was a convenience store owned by the same family. Now, here is some restaurant scoop. Mofo, which is one of my absolute favorite restaurants, starting tonight, they're offering a 5-course tasting menu that's very reasonably priced because they want to be able to give this to their restaurant community. They want the restaurant servers to come in and afford it. 5 daily specials for an average of $12, or the full 5 courses, $65 with a wine pairing. Just to name a couple things, lemon fish crudo style and a sweet pea puree with shaved radish blossom, and pandanus leaf. How about jasmine tea glazed grilled quail with a roast pepper, and peanut puree with a blackberry and red leaf spinach salad? Oh my goodness. How about for dessert, sticky rice crispy treat with strawberries, Thai basil, and Creole cream cheese ice cream. So every night, tasting menu, adventurous new things going on at MoFo.
Very wow. exciting. Gee. Well, great. Thank you so much.
Oh, and the wines, add them on for $20. That's 5 glasses of wine for $20. Be careful.
Thank you, Poppy. And we turn to Mr. John to talk about 2 totally different exhibit. So we're remembering somebody, and we're also finally remembering the legacy of someone else. But we'll start first with Archbishop Phillip Hannan.
Yes, there's a new show at the old Ursuline Convent on Charter Street. And, you know, being New Orleanians, as we all are, you know, archbishops have come and gone. But when you say archbishop, you mean Phillip Hannan.
Yes.
Even though he's retired, what, in 1988, he's still the archbishop, or was the archbishop. Well, the convent, what it's done is put on a major show of memorabilia relating to his life from childhood to just before his death. It's a terrific show, over 100 pieces, but it's really, really great with this show is when you go in that place, you're looking at 2 things. One, the life of the archbishop, but also this wonderful architecture within the convent itself because of restored portion of the convent. But it can be very moving. In the very beginning, they show his photographs with his family, his 7 brothers, his mother and father, and his sister growing up in Washington, D.C. And then, of course, a lot of people enjoy the part of his wartime years when he was the chaplain for the 82nd Airborne in Europe during the war. And then goes on through that, and then he became a very good friend of John F. Kennedy after the war when he was serving as an auxiliary bishop in Washington, D.C., and then on to moving to New Orleans. But particularly moving to me were his diaries and his letters home during the war, and how he was describing the life that he was encountering with the people, the refugees, the concentration camp that he visited. Mm. And that was extremely moving. You have all the objects and everything. You know, you see the uniforms and the murals and the photographs, but the personal touches. This is what really gets you. The letters home, and also the letters when he was the auxiliary bishop and became good friends with John Kennedy, after Kennedy died. Well, back they talked on the phone all the time. In fact, he was an advisor to Kennedy on religious matters, on Catholic matters, dealing with the great population, the Protestant population in the United States. But after when Kennedy was assassinated, Jackie Kennedy asked for him to deliver the eulogy, apparently much to the consternation of his family, because she wrote this touching little letter to him stating that, you know, tell him I wanted you to do it and I threw a fit until you agreed to do it. But then they show a videotape of the eulogy, extremely moving eulogy that he gave to for Kennedy. And he also officiated the graveside services of Robert Kennedy and Jackie Kennedy, too.
He had many
lifetimes. It was really interesting. His life in New Orleans was bookended by 2 hurricanes. He was sent to New Orleans right after Hurricane Betsy in 1965. And when they asked him to come down, he said, well, let me pray on it. He says, no, you're going to New Orleans. Nothing to pray about, you're going to New Orleans. And, of course, in Katrina, he was one of the refugees standing out by the causeway and was airlifted to the North Shore, where he spent the remaining of his years.
And I have seen the exhibit in its many rooms, and I know now they're also calling it the Catholic Cultural Center, but I think of it as the Ursuline Convent. Mm-hmm. But it's up through May 26th.
May 26th. It's got a really clever, well, actually, the title of the show parallels the title of his book, The Archbishop Wore Combat Boots.
Very good.
And his combat boots are there.
Yes. And moving on, last week we lost a longtime New Orleans artist, George Dureau, who was quite a French Quarter fixture. There was a great story in The Advocate, kind of an overall feature character sketch of him and the New Orleans and the Quarter community, too. Mm-hmm. But what a talented artist in so many ways, wasn't he?
Well, he was
a character. He was a character.
Well, I was going to say, you know, he was not only a giant in the New Orleans contemporary art world, but he was also a bigger-than-life character in the French Quarter, too. And, you know, he gained his national reputation, international reputation, not so much for his paintings, but for his photographs. And he was a superb photographer, and we have some stills we'll show you in a moment about that.
Yeah, before we do that, though, especially if someone has never heard of George Dureau, which, you know, shame on them, but if they're new to New Orleans, we have an excerpt from a feature that was done at WYS in the early 1990s. And Andy Calandry is the narrator, Lynn Ann was producer. Let's take a look.
When I was a young person in my 20s, I remember the floats coming down Royal Street, and I had an apartment right there, 600 block. The floats would come down the street, and they looked like they were of the same material as the buildings. The buildings were a little bit less finished up then, a little bit less restored. But the light playing on the powdery buildings and on the papier-mâché floats looked very much alike. In this picture, my feeling that the floats belong to the city and belong to the buildings has come back. And I've made that funny analogy happen in a curious, painterly kind of way here, in that the building is partly like a float, in that it's not a complete building. It's a column, it's a symbolic building, a column, a statue, a step, a such and such. And the floats at the same time have become more like buildings. They're about as complete or incomplete as the building is. So there's the similarity between how much of the float and how much of the building you get, and that they both have sort of the same elements.
Responding to a call from the Arts Council of New Orleans for its public art project, nationally known artist and photographer George Dureau proposed a 24-foot-long triptych with a Mardi Gras parade as the subject for the ballroom at Gallier Hall.
A storyline developed after a while so that between two floats, these things would be happening and you'd get a glimpse of Gallier Hall from the outside, a sort of a mixed up or symbolic glimpse of what the building looks like in the back. As it progressed then, it went from the drawings through drawing on the big canvases, and it went from being just two floats very stuck in the picture and the figures trying to be there to the floats parting more, and it got to be called the parade paused, because the center canvas then was Gallier Hall in the background and a lot of different people coming and going and about to have some tableau that is not fully described, some what's going to happen here sort of tableau. Someone described my paintings as a moment right after a character exposition and just before the first act takes place, and you know something's going to happen, you're not quite sure what's going to happen. So the characters are all sort of defined, as are the floats, in a portrait kind of way, and you're waiting to see what happens. But it's sort of just the nature of my painting to do that.
Talk about being missed, and as you had just mentioned, his photography work, of course, is a whole other aspect of his career.
Which is really interesting, because he started off taking photographs as studies for his paintings, which was kind of interesting too, but and evolved and became better known nationally for his photographs and his iconic photographs than he was for his local paintings. Now, as a New Orleanian, I identify more with his rich, colorful, carnival paintings than I do his photographs. But you know, he was not only a master of his art, but he was also a master of living too. He just loved life, and he did some tremendous work. And these are the kind of people that you'll be reading about a century from now, and the contributions to the New Orleans art.
And the draftsman talent of that, he had studied under Caroline Dureau.
Caroline Dureau, right at LSU, and then let's see,
Charles Calandria. That's
right. And in fact, spoke at her funeral too.
Yes, as I
learned today.
Yes.
That's right.
And we should point out that you can see more work by George Dureau at Arthur Roger Gallery.
Arthur Roger Gallery, also some of the ironwork he did in one of the large gates at the New Orleans Museum of Art is there, and also the capitals at the Harris Casino, too.
That's right, the exterior of Harris,
I think
too.
He also has a mural at Spies's on Charter Street,
does.
Too.
He does, and we should say that the mural that we saw in the video is still there in
still
the Grand Ballroom at Gallier Hall.
So public art is very visible.
Very visible. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
And we're talking to Mr. Richard Sexton about a brand new book. Now, you've heard Richard Sexton's name many times before, because you certainly would know about New Orleans Elegance and Decadence and books on Seaside, Rosemary Beach, and another one on New Roads, which we'll talk about a little later. But tell us about this brand new Creole World book. It's so beautiful, and I know we'll be showing some images too.
Yes, well, thank you. It is a book and an exhibit, and we have it in book form here today, Creole World, Photographs of New Orleans and the Latin Caribbean Sphere. And that pretty much explains it. It's a very simple concept. We all
we'll
know
be
that
showing
adage
some images too. Yes.
Of New Orleans being the northernmost Caribbean city. So I've tried to portray that.
Yes, indeed. And we're going to show a few images I know you'll share with us that you really did focus on. Here we are.
This Where is a gate. This is in the old cemetery Lorena in Cienfuegos in Cuba. The identical gate, which is also in the book, is at St. Louis III.
Is that really?
And there's so many of our, cousins between Cuba and Haiti. And
this is also Cienfuegos, which is known as the French town in Cuba because it was founded by the original settlers were from Louisiana and Bordeaux. And they moved to Cuba after the American Louisiana Purchase.
Mm, all those cultural connections.
This is in Havana. This is Parque Central. That's a statue of José Martí in the background. And this sort of became the symbolic front lead image of the book because I like the way life and art are sort of aligned there. And it's kind of a view from behind, which I think is the way I decided to tell the Creole story. It's sort of a backdoor story in a way.
Well, I also like the essays, Jay Edwards and John Lawrence
contribute
to your book.
Yes, the wonderful contributions to the book, both. And Jay Edwards' essay in particular, because he goes into all the complexity of Creole, as its meaning, its ancient meaning, its evolution over time, how it's used differently in different parts of the Creole world. So it really elucidates the topic. It's a great starting
And as you said, brand new exhibit at the historic New Orleans collection, and the opening, and with the reception next Tuesday, right?
Yes.
And some more images
22nd.
Too. Here we
this
are.
Is a society tomb. We all know society tombs well in Louisiana. This one is for cab drivers, and that's in Ecuador.
So fraternal organization for cab drivers.
Yes. This is a house in Treme, Germaine Vitry house. The original occupant family, they were from Haiti. The Vitrys, and Louise Vitry was in placage with a Frenchman who lived in the quarter. Mm-hmm. Here, ending in one of the more abstract ways, we have this juxtaposition of Central City with the Superdome. And most of the time, I was inspired to photograph things in Latin America because it reminded me of New Orleans, and this is kind of the reverse in that case.
And of course, the publisher of this magnificent book, and I want to hold it up just to show you also the incredible size, and once again, Tuesday night is the special reception, so you can see it, but look at the size of this. And
it's a nice
and published
book.
By the Historic New Orleans Collection with the exhibit there, too, so you can see the photos in person starting next Tuesday.
It's
Thank
got,
you.
Yes. Yeah, it's got a great photograph of George Dureau studio in here, too.
That's right,
there
you
is
do.
George
Dureau. You do.
Well,
one of his French Quarter studios. Well, great. Thank you very much, Richard. And we turn to Alan. That Ricky Graham is at it again.
Yes, just when you thought it was safe to go back to the theater, they're back. Ricky Graham, the clown prince of New Orleans comedy, Varley Jean Merman, the illegitimate daughter of Ernest Borgnine and Ethel Merman, Brooklyn Schaefer, New Orleans' own Becky Allen herself, filling in for Sean Patterson, are the Golden Girls. It's a TV series script that leaves off where last year's Golden Girls TV scripts were reenacted again by the actors on the stage at Mid-City Theater. Ricky Graham, of course, set in Miami. The Golden Girls was a TV show, in case you forgot, that starred the amazing Betty White along with Bea Arthur, Estelle Getty, and Rue McClanahan. It was in the top 10 TV series running for 6 out of its 7 season run. And there's Varley, of course. One cannot say enough good thing about these actors. Varley Jean plays the Bea Arthur role of Dorothy, while Ricky plays her mom Sophia. Brooklyn and Becky play Blanche and Rose, while Brian Johnson plays some other roles. It's a fun night out for theater. You know, it's great to see all these TV characters come to life, and interspersed between them are actual TV commercials from the era. So it really makes you feel like you're watching TV, but on a stage. Mm-hmm. It's on every night at 8 o'clock, and next Sunday at 6 p.m. There will be no performance this Sunday due to the Easter holiday, however. Moving on, wanted to talk a little bit about Reflections 2. Oliver Thomas, Off Parole and Ready to Talk. That's the retitled version of the play that was done by Oliver Thomas and Anthony Bean. It has not changed much from its previous iteration when it was just simply Reflections. That stars, of course, the former city council member and mayoral hopeful Oliver Thomas, started back in 2011, shortly after his sentence was over. The piece was written by Bean and Thomas in 2010, and I will tell you that it's essentially a story about Thomas's life from the time that he was getting into trouble, the time through his prison sentence, and the time as he emerged from prison. The piece opens with Thomas playing himself, with Gwendolyn Foxworth playing his wife, And this time they have two guest stars to play themselves in the work. Here is Cynthia Willard Lewis, the former city council person with actor Harold X. Evans. And then there's Gail Glapion, the former Orleans Parish School Board president you see at the right, along with other cast members. As you might imagine, this is a very tough piece for Thomas. It forces him to examine the meaning of his life. And essentially, the most interesting part of it is the course of the work that takes you to the prison where he is actually interfacing with all of the young men, and again, many young black men incarcerated in prison, mostly for drug charges. Thomas confesses that he doesn't understand exactly why he was compelled to take the small sum of $15,000. Charles Bosworth is the narrator and talks a little bit about that. He acts as both a reporter and a commentator on the life.
Former broadcaster.
Yes, Charles indeed. Bosworth. And of course, right behind him, Alfred Aubrey and other cast members there with Anthony Bean. They're all really good, but again, for this particular play, I would say that Thomas, I got the feeling that he was really feeling this time around. The last time, a lot of people were there to kind of cheer him on. This time, I think he feels like doing this role again might have been a little bit more stinging for him to do this performance. In other words, I kind of felt like it needed to be updated a little bit because he was dwelling in the past a little bit more than he should have. And this is a man, after all, who would have been the mayor, you know, the man who would be mayor only a few years ago. Here's a picture of Oliver in his better days when he was still working at City Hall, when he was at the Gallier Hall reviewing stand. And again, Thomas's acting, as I said, seemed a little bit more forced this time around. But again, it's worth seeing if you haven't seen it yet. Reflection 2 continues through Sunday the 27th. Wanted to announce something else coming on. The citywide auditions for acting is going to go at the Stage Door Canteen this Saturday. It'll be the first round of two rounds of auditions. And this will take place at the Stage Door Canteen. Parking is going to be available on site behind the museum. But you need to bring 20 resumes with attached headshots to the Stage Door Canteen. And by the way, the Stage Door Canteen Museum right now, that stage is hosting the Andrews Brothers. Fabulous show. We'll talk about it next week on a review. But if you get a chance to go to the audition, please make sure your name is either A through M from 12 to 1:30, and then from 1:30 to 3. That's the way it's going to go. Aside from the National World War II Museum, listen who's going to be auditioning for roles. So this is very important. Anthony Bean, Cripple Creek Theater, Elm Theater, Goat in the Road Productions, JPAS, The NOLA Project, Southern Rep, and Rivertown Theaters for the Performing Arts in Kenner. And speaking of Rivertown Theaters for the Performing Arts, they have their own auditions that are going to be held next weekend. So keep that in mind as well if you'd like to be in one of their upcoming productions. Now, John, you were talking about art, and I think you'll be pleased to note that the New Orleans Museum of Art and the NOLA Project are going to be continuing their series of productions in the Walda and Sidney Bestoff Sculpture Gardens in City Park. I got to tell you about this. This time, they have three separate tracks for what is going to be Adventures in Wonderland, written by Peter McElligott. And if you want to go on the track, which will be medium pace, that's the Red Queen's walking track. Everyone's encouraged to wear red on this one. You're going to move from one scene to the other, but there will be no chairs or blankets allowed. If you want to go on the faster track, that's going to be the Cheshire Cat's fast track. Everybody's going to be encouraged to wear blue on this one. Again, no blankets or chairs. And then finally, the Mad Hatter sit-down tea party will take place in the Pine Grove. Everybody who wants to sit down on a chair or to bring a blanket will be encouraged to do
so
there.
I might go that way.
And you're going to wear green for that one. So you're either going to wear red, blue, or green to go to the three tracks.
Okay, thank you very much, Alan. And now it's time, though, for our artist spotlight. Tonight we are featuring two works of art. The first is Trinity by Mississippi artist Kathy Hegman. The second is Altar Table by New Orleans resident David Goodman. They are both included in the group exhibit Artists of Faith at Carol Robinson Gallery. That's through April 26th. Check out carolrobinsongallery.com for more information. And don't forget to visit WYES.org to see our online calendar. Also, you can see our program on demand on our WYES website, too. Now, New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Cynthia Lepretine gave us the names of the two mounted statues in the French Quarter, each honoring a person who fought the British, Andrew Jackson and Joan of Arc. Now, tonight's question. Two 19th century buildings in the city are active cathedrals. What are their names and what religions do they serve? Email your answers to steppinout@wys.org. Our prizes, a Louisiana Life magazine subscription, a gift certificate for Vianne's Tea House, offering their culinary gourmet tea experience for two. Tonight we also have a t-shirt is worn by WYS staffer Steen Golubieski with the message, who, what, where, why? from our friends at wearablevegetables.com. And we also have a copy of The Paintings of Alan Flatman by John Kemp from Pelican Publishing. So, and now our picks of the week. And let me just show you once again how beautiful, and we'll be showing more of it in coming weeks. This is a great book. Congratulations.
Thank you. Okay.
Now our picks. Poppy.
I say, happy Easter. Have brunch with Ralph Brennan. There are great buffets downtown at the Redfish Grill and on Veterans at the Heritage Grill, and a fabulous a la carte brunch menu at Cafe B on Metairie Road.
All right. Thank you, John.
Okay. At the Contemporary Arts Center, there's a show called 30 Americans, from African-American artists from all over the country will be there. And also down in the Bywater at the Wellness Center, actually the second story gallery, the art of Laurie Ketteringham and Deborah Federico.
At the Healing Center,
at the Healing Center,
yeah,
right.
Very good. Alan.
It's Cheetah, not Rita. Cheetah Rivera will be at Le Petit Theater on Saturday night. If you don't have tickets yet, check it into it because it may be possible to still go. And then, of course, on Tuesday, we're going to have the Louisiana Philharmonic Orchestra, the Fidelity Concert in the Park. That's going to be free admission, Gold Ring, Woldenburg, Great Lawn at City Park.
That is so much fun. Richard.
Yes, well, I have the exhibit coming up for Creole World, which I have been exclusively focused on for
but we want to mention one other book in the more recent past.
Yes, okay. New Roads and Old Rivers, my most recent book that's currently in release.
Yes.
And that's on Pointe-Coupee Parish.
Yes, and once again, congratulations on that, too. And before I go to my picks, I want to show you, once again, what a beautiful book this is. And now my picks, Our Lady of Good Counsel Catholic Church, that's on Louisiana Avenue. They're celebrating the feast day. Next Wednesday with the Mass at 7 p.m., the Reverend Monsignor Christopher Rinaldi will be the celebrant. And also soprano soloist Melissa Brocato and our own Brian Morgan will be on the pipe organ, too. Consult the newspapers, by the way, for information on the numerous Easter parades. And as Poppy and I will attest to, you gotta get, for those Easter baskets, you gotta get your gold brick, your heavenly hash. What else, Poppy?
Where is the Elmer Easter bunny, Peggy?
I know, we couldn't make it this year.
He's out for Passover.
Oh, yeah, that's what it is. And yes, absolutely. Thank you all very much, and thank you all for watching. Good night.
Support for Steppin' Out is made possible by Yes Portrait. New Orleans portrait artist Pragati Dar specializes in personal portraits in oil or pencil. She uses her many years of experience to bring her portraits to life. More information is available at yesportrait.com.